Hello and welcome again to Lifestreams. I'm your host, Lee Jenkins, and that's exactly what I want to talk about today is Lifestreams. And in Proverbs, it tells us to guard our hearts, for out of it flow the springs of life. And that's what I want to talk to you about today. And everybody loves a good quote. And there's something about the, the combination of the philosophical and the bits of truth, yet it's succinct. And I even have an app on my phone that I go through. It's basically just a note app. But I go through, and anytime I come across a good quote, I just punch it into my phone. And I think it was in like 1975, a cartoonist Walt Kelly wrote in one of his comic strips that we have found the enemy, and it is us. And it's kind of a chuckle. But for many Christians, that is a very true statement. We have found the enemy, and it is us. And sometimes we are our own worst enemy because of our thinking, because of the lies that we continue to allow the enemy to tell us. And the writer of the book of James, he writes that temptation comes from our own desires. So from what is tempting us actually comes from inside of us. It's not God tempting us, or a lot of times it's not Satan tempting us. It's what is actually in our own heart. It's in our own desires. And then it uses the word that temptation comes from our own desires, which entice us and drag us away. It's this idea that we're hooked and that we're helpless when confronting with our own humanity, with our own sinful nature. And then he goes on to say that these desires give birth to sinful actions, and when sin is allowed to grow, it gives birth to death. And that's found in James 1, 14 and 15. And Jesus kind of said it a different way. He said that in Mark chapter 7, verse 20, he said, what comes out of our heart is what defiles us. So what is coming out of our heart, or what is tempting us, our own desires, our what we're being enticed with, is already part of us in our sinful nature, in what we were as the old man, or who we used to be before we became a Christian. So maybe I want to shake you a little bit of your theology, perhaps shape your theology, or maybe just reiterate perhaps what you already know. But it's so easy for us to forget as Christians when we're in the moment, when we're under attack, and again, we want to believe these lies that Satan is telling us. So I want to take us back to the beginning. I want to take us back to Genesis. I'm going to take us back to the garden and Adam and Eve. And I kind of want to paraphrase as we're going through this. And it's not verbatim. It's not word for word. It's not maybe historically. But back in the beginning, Adam and Eve were created in God's image. They were created with the character of God. And God even makes the comment that it is all good. And so he takes Adam and Eve and he places them in this garden that he's created. And in that moment, he grants them not only relationship, that he has a direct relationship with them. They know him. He knows them. They know God. There is this communion. The word talks about that God, in the cool of the day, that he would come and that he would walk with Adam and walk with Eve. And so there was this direct connection, communion, relationship that was there. that they shared. And also part of that picture was that God gave them dominion, gave them authority over the earth, over the plants, over the animals, over their garden, and that they had control of it. They had authority. They had that dominion, and they were given one command. And that command was that they should not eat of the one tree that was in the center of the garden, the tree of knowledge of good and evil. And sin then enters the equation when ultimately they sought to be like God. The serpent comes to Eve, and we've all heard the story as how she is convinced, and the serpent is asking her, he's taking God's word and what God commanded him, and he twists a little bit, and did God say that you can't eat of any trees in the garden? And she said, no, well, we can eat of anything we want except for the one tree that's in the middle of the garden, the tree of good and evil, or the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. So it was evident that she knew what the command was. She knew what God's will was for their life. And yet she listens to this serpent, and she is convinced. And let's go into Genesis chapter 3, and let's start at just 3:1, that the serpent was the shrewdest of all the wild animals that the Lord had made. And one day he asked the woman, did God really say you must not eat the fruit of any of the trees in the garden? Of course we may eat fruit from the trees in the garden, the woman replied. It's only the fruit from the tree in the middle of the garden that we're not allowed to eat. And God said you must not eat it or even touch it, or if you do, you will die. You won't die, the serpent replied. That was the first lie. For God knows that your eyes will be open as soon as you eat it, and you will be like God, knowing both good and evil. And the woman was convinced, and she saw that the tree was beautiful and that its fruit looked delicious, and that she wanted the wisdom that it would give her. And so she took some of the fruit and ate it, and then she gave some to her husband who was with her, and he ate it too. And at that moment, their eyes were open, and they suddenly felt shame at their nakedness. And so they sewed fig leaves together to cover themselves. So they knew what the command was that God had given them. They knew his will, his desire, and yet they chose, because they desired to be like God. They desired the knowledge. They desired to know something that they didn't have any business even knowing. And what was the result? And the result was the relationship between them and God, although maybe not severed, was seriously damaged. There was now this disobedience had come between them. Things were no longer the same. The communion, the direct access to God, was severed. And in response to this, God, because of their sin and because of God's justness, God had to send them away from his presence. And the last thing that happened was that the dominion that Adam and Eve had been given over their lives, over their surroundings, over the earth, was taken from them. They deliberately gave it then, because of their disobedience, they gave that dominion to Satan, to the enemy. But God had a plan. This didn't take him by surprise, and the Word talks about that even before the foundations of the earth was laid, that God had this plan already in motion, because knowing the beginning and the end, he knew that we would sin. He knew that given the option, that the potential was there for them to sin, but the ability to choose, this having free will, is the only way that true love can operate. If we try to control something and it doesn't have a, you're going to love me irregardless, that's not free will, that's not true love. So God had this plan, and from Adam and Eve and from their descendants, he would raise up nations. And he chose then through the person of Abram, who would then become Abraham, that he would raise up the nation of Israel as his own. And he entered into a covenant that they would be his people and he would be their God. And throughout all of their history, there were times it was almost like in a cycle of obedience and disobedience, and they would be obedient and then they would fall away from God. They would become disobedient. God would correct them. God would discipline. They would then repent and return to God, and the cycle would continue itself. And it was through this nation of Israel that God would carry out his plan for reconciliation, and it was through this nation of Israel that the birth of Jesus Christ would happen. And so Jesus Christ came, but Israel, the Jews, they didn't like Jesus Christ any more than they had liked the prophets that God had sent before, and they ended up, we all know the story from the crucifixion and the death of Jesus Christ. And yet after 3 days, God would raise him from the dead victorious, then over death, over sin. And it was then through that reconciliation comes, and it was through Jesus Christ then that we again have that direct access to God, because God, Jesus is our mediator, and the blood of Jesus then has overshadowed and covered our sin. Part of this reconciliation then is that once we come to Jesus and through that access and through our confession with our mouth, the word says, and we repent and we make the proclamation then that Jesus Christ is the Lord of our life, that I'm no longer in control, but he is, and I make him Lord of my life. And through that moment, God doesn't simply patch us up. It's not like you've taken an old teddy bear or somebody that's been injured, and through that we bandage them up, we patch them up, maybe a splint here, a cast here, but that's not what God does. That's not what God did in that moment. And what he does, the word says, is that he creates a new creature, a new creation, and that he, the word describes it, that he gives us a heart of flesh rather than a heart of stone. And because remember that out of the heart comes what defiles us. So God replaces our old nature with a new nature, and we have a new heart. And so along with our new heart and our new creation, we are also freed then from the bondage that we're under of sin. And then at that point, we are free to choose life over death. And with our new heart and as a new creation, then we're restored to what God intended in the beginning. With our new heart, we can know God's will for our life. We can know God's intentions for our life. We can hear God's voice, so we have that communion with God. We have God's printed word that we can read, we can study. We see how God was revealed through the person of Jesus Christ. And so we are, so we have that communion restored, and once again that we have been given dominion, we've been given authority over our lives and over sin. And so with that freedom comes responsibility, and that's, I think, where a lot of Christians, we struggle with that because we fail to understand our identity in Christ and what authority we do have, and the fact that our sins have been forgiven. So the enemy can't stand before God and accuse us because those sins have been washed away. So what does he do? He tries to attack us with our and affect our thinking, so we question who it is that we truly are and where we are and what authority that we have. So it's all of our messed up thinking, and we fail to recognize this authority and dominion that we have. So what do we do with this freedom and the responsibility for that freedom? What do we do with it? And so what do we do with this new heart? Well, the word there in Proverbs 4:23. And tells us that we're to guard it. And I'm reading out of the New Living Translation, it says, "Guard your heart above all else, for it determines the course of your life." Guard your heart above all else, for it determines the course of your life. And I went through and looked at some different translations, and there's one, it's called the Passion Translation, and it's worded, it says, "So above all, guard the affections of your heart," and that kind of lends itself to the serving or seeking idols. What idols do we have in our life? What are our affections? What do we love? And does that interfere with our affection for God? "So above all, guard the affections of your heart, for they affect all that you are. Pay attention to the welfare of your innermost being, for from there flows the wellspring of life." So it's out of our heart, it's out of our affections, it's out of our innermost being, and that we need to be diligent. And in Proverbs 4:23, out of the Amplified, that's the way it's worded. It says, "To watch over your heart with all diligence, for from it flow again the springs of life." And water is a source. We can't live very long. We can't live at about 3 days without water. And the Contemporary English Version says to carefully guard your thoughts, because they are the source of true life. And we go back to the scripture out of James that I kind of opened up with, and that how us being tempted is from our own desires. And so this is saying carefully guard your thoughts and your thought life. What are you reading? What are you watching? What are you watching on television, on social media? What are you listening to? What are you thinking about? And where do we focus our attention? And is it on the truth of our identity of who we are in Christ? or is it on what somebody is saying about us or what the enemy is saying about us, perhaps through social media or through maybe our circle of influence? And in the English, that was the contemporary English version, the English Standard Version says, keep your heart with all vigilance, for from it flow the springs of life. So here we hear this idea of being vigilant, being watchful, guarding, and because it's all very important of not only who we are, but who we continue to be and the direction of our life. Several years ago, time flies now. Was it back in the 90s? There was this movement, if you want to call a fad, it's probably a closer representation of the WWJD movement or concept, and it was, what would Jesus do? And they had necklaces and bracelets and, all kinds of jewelry that you could wear, and it was to be a reminder, and the concept was good because it was about us making a conscious decision based upon what would Jesus do in that particular moment or that circumstance, or if Jesus himself were there, what would he do? How would he act? What would he say? And it is a excellent reminder because it changes our focus from what it is that we're hearing to what is the truth of the word. What is it that God is saying about me? And what does his word say? And how does that direct my life instead of what the world's idea of wisdom or what they think we should do? And so many Christians struggle because we fail to grasp the truth of our identity is that we're in control. And with that control and with that responsibility, we open the door to our lives to the enemy, not understanding that I'm in control, and depending on what I'm watching, what I'm reading, what I'm thinking, what I allow into my life affects my heart. And that's why all these scriptures from out there at Proverbs 4 was to guard and to be vigilant, to be diligent, to be watchful, because it impacts who we are. And so we not only open the door of our lives to the enemy, but everything in our lives. We open literally the door to our homes. What are we allowing into our house? And what are we allowing in on our computers, on our phones, on our televisions? What are we, whatever we allow into our home affects our families. And more than that, it affects not only our families, but it affects our futures. And even beyond that, it affects our eternities, or maybe the eternities of our kids or our loved ones. See, when it comes down to it, we have been given this clean slate. It's been wiped clean. We've been given a new beginning. So we're a new creation in Christ Jesus. We're not the old person that we used to be. We're not just bandaged up and patched up but we're brand new. We're brand new. So part of that is that our shackles have been removed. The Bible talks a lot about that, the bondage of sin and what we're shackled to, and that we drag our past along with us. But those shackles have been removed, that this image that the prison doors have been opened. And in that, we have been set free. We've been brought out of the darkness of confinement. We've been brought out of the darkness of a dungeon or a prison, out into the light of day, out into the light of truth and life. And we've been granted then access to God the Father. We've been granted relationship with the Son. We have been granted this communion that we can commune daily in that relationship, and that we're alive. And again, that we have been granted dominion. I can't repeat that enough, that we have been granted this position of power and authority over our lives. We don't have to follow what our nature, what our old nature was. We don't have to follow what our these lies that we are being confronted by the enemy. We don't have to allow our past or how we grew up to identify who we are, because we're now this new creature in Christ. So we've been granted dominion. So now what do? Now we have to guard that, and we have the choices that we can continue to be free, or we can turn around and we can go back into that prison. We can close that door. We can put ourselves back in bondage if we choose. We can put ourselves back in bondage to sin. We can hand over, just like Adam and Eve did, we can hand over that dominion that we have, the authority we have, back to the enemy, back to the world. So I want to encourage you this morning, don't believe Satan's lies. Don't let him convince you that you are who you used to be, and don't go back to that bondage. And I just want to close today that if you have never started that journey with Christ, you can do so very easily, just making the confession with your mouth that Jesus is the Lord of your life. Ask him to come into your heart. Repent. Tell him that you're sorry for the sins that you have created, the sins that you've committed, and how you have lived your life for yourself up to this point. And for those of you that are struggling as Christians, ask God to reveal to you the identity that you have in him, who you truly are, how he sees you, that you are loved, that you are a son or a daughter, that you are an heir, that you have direct access to him, that you have direct communion with him, and you have dominion over who you are. And just want to, again, thank you for just the opportunity to come in into your home and speak to you, and perhaps just shake you a little bit into the truth of God's Word. Look forward to seeing you next time and enjoying you being here on Lifestreams.